Hello, student. Good morning to all of you. This is a fourth session. So, let me first take the just give me a minute, students, to confirm. So here in students, good morning, good morning. Good morning, Nishank. Priya, good morning. Kotla S. N. Gupta, good morning to all of you. I'm fine, students. Had a bad throat and down with fever. I suppose even Om sir is, I think, down with fever. In fact, he has quarantined himself. In fact, his and also Purnamas sir also. So primary is that everyone is grappling with fever and all. And the only factor is that the traveling that we do primarily from the studio to our home. So that becomes a bit risky factor, but still we have to manage the lecture. The show has to go on. So, so students, what I'm going to do right now would be that I'm going to start with PGBP, because house property primarily is something which I was supposed to do, but we will do it after PGBP and the next capital gains topic is done. For the reason being, PGBP and capital gains, students wanted it to be done earlier. That is what they have suggested to me, and therefore I'll do first PGBP and capital gains, and then the small topic of house property, salary, clubbing, chapter 6A. Those are just followed up in that way, so that knowing also the time factor, we should try to take the important topics earlier, and thereafter we will take the small topics later on. Now, students, it's fine primarily, but still the medication is going on, but still I'm fine right now to at least take my lectures. So that much fit and fine I am right now to take the lectures, but only the factor is that a bit of medication is going on. Om sir has communicated to me, I think morning your IT lectures are not right now, for he is also in a very bad shape right now. So he has just communicated to me that to communicate to all the students just that he will, once he is fine, maybe by this week or so, by next week he'll compensate for his particular session. So nevertheless, hopefully we actually, all of students, all of you also take care of yourself. Please don't move out as much as, try to restrict your movement outside. This is a time wherein primarily, see, for us, we don't have any option. We have to go. But at least for your side, you have to be at, you can easily be at home and try to watch your lectures, try to do your study and minimize your outdoor outing at this stage. So therefore, at least you should be very careful about your involvement when you interact with the outdoor factors. Okay. On that note, students, let's start without now taking it further. Good morning, Dharmesh. So now, students, Priyanka, good morning. So let's start with this one. Now we were in, we'll start with the PGBP part first. Students, as we all know, we have now done with the residential status revision, also the scope of the total income, and also the exemption part. The exemption, these are the three particular topics or the area that we have discussed: residential status, the scope of the total income, and with the scope of the total income, we have also taken that section 9 income which is deemed to accrue rise in India. Isn't it? That section 9 is also being considered in our previous lecture. Now the third particular part which we will be looking into it, the third particular part, or we have already have looked into it, was that section number 10, the exemption particular part. Now with that, we proceed further, and now where we are in, we will be doing this particular PGBP, which is primarily our fourth particular area now. Now students, PGBP, primarily, first of all, just understand this, that we have to compute the total income. The entire objective is to compute the total income of a person for a particular previous year, and the previous year for all of you is previous year 1920. So the total income of a person for a previous year for you, it is 1920. It is going to be charged to tax in the next following AY. So your previous year is previous year 1920, and the relevant assessment year for which the total income is computed for the assessment year for all of you is 2021 for your examination November 20 attempt. The total income, students, is computed. Now we all know, students, we have seen, if you are a resident person, then your world income, Indian income as well as foreign income, Indian income as well as foreign income, the world income is chargeable under the act. So therefore, the world income will be computed in the manner which is laid down under the act. The world income will be computed in the manner laid down under the act. This is for whom? For the resident. For the non-resident, only the Indian income. And what is that Indian income? Income which is accrued or deemed to have accrued in India, or income which is received in India. Only the Indian income is what will be computed. Why? Only the Indian income will be computed because it is only the Indian income which is chargeable. So what is chargeable, students, only will be computed. What is chargeable is only will be computed. And how do we know that what is chargeable? That will depend upon your residential status. That will depend upon your residential status. So whereas if you are a resident person, then the world income is taxable, is chargeable, and whatever is chargeable will be computed. Whatever is chargeable will be computed. And if you are a non-resident, then only two categories of the income is chargeable, and only those two categories of the income will be computed further. How to compute is our next question. How to compute is our next question. So what to compute depends on the residential status. What to compute depends on what is chargeable. What is chargeable depends on the residential status. Once you know what to compute, then the next question is how to compute. Once you know what to compute, then the next question is how to compute. How to compute 5 heads of income. We all have the 5 heads of income. So how to compute 5 heads of income. So each of the heads of income has its distinct mode of computation. Each of the heads of income has got the distinct mode of computation. So we all know 5 heads of income are there, students. We all know 5 heads of income are there. Shushant is asking, can anyone tell from when the lecture of EIS and SM will continue? Shushant, Om sir has told me that by next week he will try to start because his health is not well. So therefore, in this case, he is going to start with the next week. Okay. Venkat, good morning. Rati, good morning. Very good morning. So students, 5 heads of income. How to compute 5 heads of income? Now in that 5 heads of income, students, in that 5 heads of income, one of the heads is PGBP. Now the best part, students, is each heads of income has a distinct mode of computation. Each heads of income has got a distinct mode of computation. And now if you want, you can just take a note of this particular part, students, because this will be the basis of our further discussion. So we have 5 heads of income. So computation of total income that we all do. Five heads of income, and there is a salary. The first head, section 15 to section 17. Although section you need not remember, but as much as possible, at least I can give you the range of the sections which are there in each and every heads of income. The range of the section. First for salary, second is house property, section 22. To section 27, third is PGBP, section 28 to 44DA, capital gains, fourth is CG, 45. 255A. And the last one is IFOS 56 to 59. The last one is IFOS 56 to 59. Okay, students. 56 to 59. Now, students, if you are through with this, I'm just giving a quick macro overview of the competition so that the base is clear in your mind. Whenever the competition process has to begin, the base is clear in your mind. Students, herein, as far as the head salary is concerned, there is hardly any competition. Hardly any competition. There is only two deduction is given to you. Actually, there are three deductions, but roughly two deduction. And they are, one is a standard deduction. How much is the standard deduction? Can you let me know? Just to test you on this. How much is the standard deduction? In salary head, how much is the standard deduction? Sushant, Rahul, Nishank, Deepak, Priyanka, Tharun, Srivastava, Pavan, Chinna, Tinad, Kotla. Indeed, students, please don't make this mistake. Till FA 18, last year means for which attempt? May 19, November 19, the standard deduction was 40,000 flat. Flat. Right now, this is 50,000 flat. The standard deduction is 50,000 flat. Okay, so that is one deduction, and the second deduction is the professional tax or employment tax. How much is the professional tax, by the way? Professional tax or the employment tax? Professional tax or the employment tax. How much is this particular amount? And it is, students, 2,500 rupees. Very good, students. Just remember these things. Now I'll tell you one thing, students. Just herein, there are only two deduction. Yes, that is whatever is paid. It has to be paid. Students, the only two deductions are there as far as the PG, as far as salary head is concerned. There is one more allowance, entertainment allowance, but forget that particular thing because that is only meant for the government employee, and that too whose salary is somewhere in 50s. I don't know whether there are such employee who will exist. Be that as it may, only two deductions are there. So far as the head salary is concerned, all the other under the head salary will qualify only for exemptions. So what is the focus as far as the head salary is concerned? The exemptions. Exemption when we do the allowances, exemptions when we do the retirement benefit. So our focus has to be on calculating the exemptions under the head salary. So that is our focus point, students, and that is where you have to lay your entire attention. How much is exempt in the allowance given to the employee? How much is exempt in respect of the retirement benefits given to the employees? So far as the perquisites would be concerned that we are going to do, perquisite does not have the exemptions. Perquisite is all about the valuation. At what value the perquisite will be taxable in the hands of the employee. Perquisites is all about the valuation. So whatever exemption, students, that we are going to learn or we are going to revise under the head salary would be in respect of the two aspects. One is the allowances and second is about the retirement benefit. The third aspect that we are going to revise would be on the perquisite part. On the perquisite, there is a valuations, how to value. That is all of it. This is your salary chapter. As far as the house property chapter is concerned, students, house property chapter is concerned, here what? There is section 23, and section 23 provides you the computation. We all know GAV less what? Municipal tax paid. Thereafter, you get the NAV. Paid is the key factor, students. And thereafter, the NAV. After that, standard deduction. And standard deduction, here also flat. 30% of the NAV. So here also flat. 30% of NAV is what has to be reduced from this interest on the borrowed capital. Interest on the borrowed capital is what also needs to be reduced finally to get the income from house property. This is what you will prepare so far as the house property is concerned. This is a formatted, students. This is all about the format. The computational provision. So section 23 is the computational provision. So whenever students you write in the examination this format for house property, please, if possible, if you can remember section 23 competition, like that you should write. Section 23 competition, like that you should write in the examination. If possible, please make the presentation this way. Quickly copy it on this one, students. Once you're through with this, let me know. Then I'll come to our PGUP, which are this. I'll do quickly a capital gains format and then I'll come to the PGUP. Once you're done with this, let me know. Okay, students, now everyone is through. So this is about the section 23. Trinath. Okay, now I'll come to PGUP, but before that, even the capital gains, students, the capital gains format, which you all are aware, the format, how it goes herein. So students, if it is a non-depreciable asset, there is also for depreciable asset, but just let's look upon to non-depreciable asset, which is section 48. For that, there is a full value of consideration, less expenses on transfer, isn't it? The way municipal tax paid, just here we have got expenses on transfer, then what? Net sale consideration, and from this COA, if it is a short term COA, and then less COI, and finally what the capital gains, which I'll say this to be a short-term capital gain or loss, which I'll say finally as what? STCG or STCL. So that is how you do it. STCG or STCL. Fine, students. Now, why I'm focusing more on this one? Because students, please understand, there is also section 50 in CG. I'll tell you the three competition provision in CG, which would be our next topic after PGBP. Three competition provisions are, number one, it is non-depreciable asset, which I have put across in front of you. There is also section 50 for depreciable asset. And the last one is a slum sale, section 50B. There is a format of computing the income. There is what? A format of computing the income. So we have got a perfectly laid down format on the basis of which the computation has to be done. There is also a format in the head house property, the way it is given to you in front. GAV less municipal tax paid, NAV less standard deduction, thereafter the interest. These are the format on the basis of which the IFHP income has to be computed. These are the format on the basis of which the IFHP income has to be computed. My short point is that, students, please be careful about house property CG format is there. What about PGBP? Now I come to the chapter which is our end of discussion, so that you can at least start comparing. While we do the competition, students, here, the competition, I'll now take to the next page. You can also take to the next page here. For PGBP, what you need to do? For PGBP, what do you need to do? You have to have net profit as per the books for business, net profit as per books for business, and then you have to do add and less what? Adjustment from section 28 to 43B. Adjustment from section this thing to 43B, and that is what will result into PGBP. This is your PGBP competition. Students, please write here competition the way I'm writing right now. PGBP competition. Net profit as per the books for business. Add and less the adjustment from section 28 to 43B. Add or less adjustment from section 28 to 43B. Whatever is the amount, balance is the PGBP, which you all have it over here. Nitya Shri is asking, interest on borrowed capital is 30,000 or 2 lakhs? Nitya Shri, both. Even 30,000 would be there and 2 lakhs is also there. Depending upon, we will learn. Don't worry, I will let you know on that interest on the borrowed capital part. But what you are saying, Nitya Shri, is for the SOP property. For the LOP property or DLOP property, there is no limit for that. I'll touch upon to your query when I do with you house property. Right now, I'm not focused. Let's focus on this one. Otherwise, we'll lose the track. Students, if you have completed this, let me know, because then I'm going to discuss one very important part. If you all have completed this particular format. So, students, if you now notice, if you have noticed the format clearly, one thing is very clear in your mind. PGBP, students, PGBP has got a base amount. And what is that base amount? Students, PGBP has a base amount. And what is that base amount? So the base amount is net profit as per books for business. This is the base amount. Do any other heads of income like capital gains, like house property, does it have any base amount? Does it have any base amount? And the answer is no. You can see for yourself clearly, students, that we have to, in fact, even the GAV has to be computed. Students, in the house property, even the GAV has to be computed. We all are aware, GAV computation. Remember, we have a comparison. First, arrive at the fair rent. Isn't it? So there is a step 1, step 2, step 3. On that basis, the GAV would be arrived. So therefore, there is what? There is a format in which the GAV has to be determined. Same way, when we go to capital gains, how to determine the full value of consideration? There are many sections which defines what is full value of consideration. So we have to pick up that. My submission, students, to all of you is this, that there is no base amount. There is no base amount for heads like, which is the head? Head like house property and capital gains. But when it comes to the head PGBP, suddenly we have a base amount. And that base amount is the net profit as per the books of accounts. Books means accountancy. When you say books, it means accounting. Accounting books. So whatever is the net profit as per your accounting books, which is for the business, that net profit, which is for the business as per the accounting book, on that net profit you have to do the adjustment. So what is that we do in the head PGBP? Students, what is that we do under the head PGBP? We actually don't do the computation under the head PGBP. We are not doing the computation. What we do under the head PGBP is the adjustments. Therefore, if you remember, whatever little bit you have done it in PGBP, you would have realized that what I am doing is only add less, add less, add less. That is what you are doing. A very simple example, if I have to give it to you, is the depreciation. Add depreciation as per books, less depreciation under section 32. So the bottom line therefore is, students, in under the head PGBP, while we compute, we have to do what? Adjustments. Adjustment for of the specific sections from 28 to 43B. And that adjustment has to be given on the base amount. What is the base amount? The accounting profit for business. What is the base amount? The accounting profit for business. On that base amount, give the adjustment, and that will result into what? The PGBP. That will result into the PGBP. So we are all set now, students. We are all set now for getting into the computation of the head PGBP. And the biggest section, students, for your IPCC is the section on interest. It is a section on depreciation. This is the biggest section, students. Rest of it are the simplest of the version. Shall I switch to the chart now? From this slide, now I'm switching to the chart. Again, students, those who are watching this lecture for the first time, if even that is a possibility, I have already given the chart in my Telegram channel. You can go from there and you can take the charts primarily. My humble request is that you can, if possible, take a print of the charts. That will be very handy for all of you to revise it. So let's get started, students. In this case, section 28 being the first section. Quickly, students, we will go to this one. Charging section, section 28.1, condition required to be satisfied in order to charge an income under the head PGBP. So in this case, so this is section 28.1. So this is what, students? Section 28.1. So 28.1 says what? Simply put, profit and gains from business and profession carried on by the SSE at any time during the previous year. This is what 28.1 is all about. Profit and gains from business and profession carried on by the SSE at any time during the previous year. Some of the example students have been given, but for the time being, you can skip this particular part. So you can just write herein to skip this one. At initial discussion, students, you can skip this part. And later on, towards the end, this discussion would be relevant. Right now, you can just forget it. So if you have got the hard copy, you can write skip for the time being. So 28.1 says what? That the profit and gains from the business and profession will be chargeable if it is carried on by the SSE at any time during the previous year. Again, repeat with me, students. Profit and gains from business and profession will be chargeable if it is carried on by the SSE at any time during the previous year. So that is the requirement for the purpose of the chargeability of the profit and gains. Now, to determine the profit and gains, students, as I told you just now, the profit and gains which is chargeable, how do we determine the profit and gains which is chargeable? For this, we will first take the base value, and the base value is the accounting profit for the business. The base value is the accounting profit for the business, and on that base value, we will do the further adjustments. We will do the further adjustments, and after doing the further adjustment, the net amount that I am going to get it would be the accounting profit for the business. Sorry, the profit and gains. After doing the specific adjustment from 28 to 43B, I will get the profit and gains which is chargeable. Now, students, now you will find here, section 28.2, there are specific items. Now, here, students, see the chargeability. Here it is, profit and gains. But after that, see the next particular clause onwards. The next particular clause onwards, you will find what? That there are specific items which are being targeted. What is the specific item? 28.2. What is the specific item? 28.2 says, it says what? That any compensation or any other payments due or received on termination or modification in terms of the management office or managing agency. So supposedly an agent, students, I am an agent and I was appointed by this company for 5 years. But company after 2 years, company, after 2 years, they are terminating my agency and they are giving me the compensation. They are giving me the compensation. Then in that case, students, then in that case, the compensation money which I have received, the compensation money which I have received, that will be taxed under the Act PGBP. Will it be taxed? Yes, it will be taxed. Why they are giving me the compensation? Because they have terminated my agency in 2 years itself. Earlier it was for 5 years, but in 2 years time they have terminated my agency. So therefore, whatever compensation that they have given, that compensation amount, students, that compensation amount will be what? That compensation amount will be charged under the head PGBP. Now students, please write one thing, all of you, all these sections which are there from this to this, here you will write for, they will target in your examination for MCQ. Which section I'm talking about? It 28.2 to 28.7. So that's the reason why I've made this box 28.2 to 28.7. MCQ students, they will give you small example. Small examples would be given, students. And in that particular examples, they will give you MCQ based question. So don't expect that this will be there in your descriptive questions. No, MCQ based questions, students, you have to prepare yourself. So just be conceptually be clear what these are all about. 28.3, students, 28.3, income derived by a trade or professional or a similar association from specific services rendered to its member. So students, what is this this particular thing? Like, I just have a simple example. Bombay Stock Exchange is an association. Indian Merchant Chambers is an association. Now they may be providing, now in this, like Bombay Stock Exchange, this is an association. Now their members are stockbrokers. Now to their members, if they are providing any specific services, who is providing the specific service? Bombay Stock Exchange or Indian Merchant Chambers. So there are a lot of trade bodies, isn't it? So if these trade bodies are providing specific services, to whom they are providing specific service? To their members. Then the income arising to them, will be what? Will be charged under the head PGBP. So the income, whose income? Trade body's income. For what purpose? How they have got this income? They've got this income by providing the specific service. To whom they are providing the specific services? To the members. Accordingly, in this case, this income from this specific service will be charged in their hands under the PGBP. Student, this is for importer-exporter. Importer and exporter. What happens for the importer and exporter? Generally, when I'm exporting, students, if I'm an exporter, I'm exporting the goods. Now, in final CA, students, you will learn in customs law that when you export the goods, there are a lot of export incentives. Export incentives, students, arises to you. So all these export incentives which arises to you in consequence of your export, whether this will be taxable in your hand under the PGBP? And the answer is yes. So can you see all these names? You don't have to by heart. Export incentive. What are the export incentive? Import entitlement license, DEPB, duty entitlement passbook. Don't worry, don't have to buy hard all these things, but just DBK is a drawback. DBK, students, is a drawback. So all these are nothing but the export incentives. So export incentive, will it be charged under the PGBP? And the answer is yes. So I am an exporter. By exporting the goods, I am eligible for various incentives. All these incentives, students, these incentives will be charged in my hands under the head. Under which head? Under the head PGBP. 28.4, students. 28.4. For 28.4, again, MCQ question. 28.4 is all about what? It is about... for 28.4, students. 28.4 is about what? It is about the non-monetary benefit. Non-monetary benefit. 28.4, write non-monetary benefit. I'll give an example, students. Non-monetary benefit. I am a dealer, students. I have got a dealership of Samsung. Okay. Now, Samsung has told to all the dealers that you sell 10,000 LCD. Samsung has told what? You sell 10,000 LCD, then we will give you free Singapore tickets. Free Singapore ticket, students. Now, what I have done? I have achieved the target. And I have sold 10,000 LCDs. And I have sold 10,000 LCDs. So, the sale of this 10,000 LCD, will attract the chargeability under the head PGBP? And the answer is yes. Will the receipt of the free tickets on account of achieving the sales target, is the receipt of the free tickets on achieving the sales target, whether that value of the free tickets, will that be charged in my hands as a dealer under the PGBP? And the answer is yes. Why? Because this is the benefit. Students, this is the benefit which has arised from my business. So students, 28.4 targets all the non-monetary benefits that you receive in exercise of your business. So is it chargeable under the head PGBP? And the answer is yes, it is chargeable under the head PGBP. So this is how it has to be considered. The next particular part, students, which is there, 28.5. Now, Shushant is asking, provide additional questions and MCQ for practice. I will be doing the questions from your module. I have already told earlier also. Now, the module-based questions is what I am going to do for the heads of income. 5 heads of income is there. So, I am going to select your module question primarily and we will solve few important module questions in our revisionary session. So, that is what I am going to deal with it. MCQ students, I'm telling you one thing, that please understand one thing. You do 10,000 MCQ, you will get new MCQ in the exam. So MCQ, please don't try to, at this last 2 months, my humble suggestion to all of you is that please don't focus too much on MCQ, because you do 100 MCQ or 1000 MCQ in the examination, you will get 1001 MCQ. Only factor is that whatever MCQ which the institute has given to you, say maybe in the RTP or in the module, only do that much. MCQ which the institute has given, only do that. Because what will come in the examination will be the new MCQ. And therefore, what is required for handling the MCQ effectively in the examination, what is required to handle the MCQ effectively in the examination is the conceptual clarity. If you are conceptually clear, you can crack any MCQs. So my only suggestion, students, would be that all of you, whatever MCQ based revision in the last month or the last 2 months that you will have now, please restrict your MCQ study based on whatever is given by the ICI. That's it. Don't go beyond that, because it is pointless, students. Take it from me. Whatever MCQ you keep on doing it, in the examination, you'll get only the new MCQs. So that's my humble suggestion. Anyway, so that because time would be the premium. As we proceed further, where the notes is available, which notes, Nitya Shri, which notes? This notes is, my charts are available in my Telegram channel, for which I have given the link in the description box of this video, this chart. And you can just go there, and I have told to all the students, if possible, take the print in A3 size. So hardly there are 28 pages. 28 are there, total 38 page, but you can take the print only of 28, because in between there are information about the lectures and other things and all. So 28 page, please take a print so that it becomes very handy for all of you to revise later on. Students, 28.5 now. Next one is 28.5, which is about what? It is in respect of the partners in a partnership firm. Students, partners in a partnership firm. As far as the partners in a partnership firm is concerned, students, what happens? The firm, when they pay to their partners remuneration or interest which is paid by the firm to their partners. So remuneration or interest paid by the firm to its partner, students, what happens? I'll tell you. There is one section that we will touch upon. The section is section 40B. Okay, as per the section 40B, there is a threshold amount up to which the deduction is allowed in the hands of the firm. we will see how much is the amount which is allowed as deduction in the hands of the firm. Whatever is allowed as deduction of the remuneration or the interest paid by the firm to its partner, whatever is allowed as deduction in the hands of the firm, that much of the amount is chargeable. That much of the amount is chargeable in the hands of the partner under which section 28.5. Under which section 28.5. So if you see very carefully in this regard, in this case, students, any interest, salary, bonus, commission or remuneration due or received by a partner of a firm to the extent, this is the important one, students, to the extent. So that is why I told you, whatever is allowed as deduction to the firm, deduction in respect of what? Deduction in respect of what? Deduction in respect of the payment of remuneration and interest paid by the firm to its partner. So to the amount allowed as deduction, that much of the amount will be chargeable. That much of the amount will be chargeable in the hands of the partners. Coming to the 28.5A, students, this is, you can just simply write over here, non-compete agreements. Non-compete agreements, students. Now say, for example, students, I am a lawyer. Okay, I am a lawyer, and you are giving me that, look, there is one case in the Supreme Court and you are fighting that case. You are a client, but you are giving me money not to appear, not to be your party. You are not giving me that I should represent you. You are giving me the money that I should not be representing the other party. Other party. You will say, I'll ask you, what about your case? Who is going to fight your case? You are saying, we have appointed our own lawyers. But we want that you should, if my opposite party approaches you, then you should not fight for them. Fight for him. So for doing that, they are making you a payment. For doing that, they are making you a lump sum payment. And that lump sum payment, students, is what I say. That lump sum payment is what I say to be a non-compete agreement. So that lump sum payment which has been made, this is what is known as the non-compete amount, and that exactly what it would be. 28.5A, students, is all about the non-compete agreements. So if you see again in this regard, any sum received or receivable in cash or kind under an agreement for not carrying off any business or profession, so that money which I have received to not do a thing, that money which I have received, will it be charged under the PGBP? And the answer is yes. Coming to 28.6, students, this is about the Keyman insurance policy. Keyman insurance policy. Students, for Keyman insurance policy, just write one quick note. Refer, you can say here, put an asterisk, refer note. One note, I'll just give it to you for Keyman insurance policy quickly, so that in the examination, when it comes in the MCQ, you are at least clear about how to deal with it. Keyman. Treatment of Keyman insurance policy amount. Keyman insurance policy amount received. Received by, it depends upon received by whom. Received by employee. That is, you can write in the bracket, that is beneficiary of the policy. Who is the beneficiary of the policy? Whether employee is a beneficiary, employer is a beneficiary, or a third party. If it is employee, employer. So if it is employee, taxable. Under which head? Salary. If the employer is the beneficiary, taxable under which head? Business and profession. If a third party is the beneficiary, taxable under the head IFRS. Taxable under the head IFRS. If you are all through with this, students, let me know, then we can proceed. I'll ask for this IITSM today also, sir, that when he will resume. I'll give you the exact date tomorrow in my lecture. So tomorrow also, students, Friday, Saturday, as well as on Sunday, all the three lectures I'll continue. Originally, my timetable does not have me on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Okay, but I'll continue on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday to cover up the loss of this week lecture. Okay, so I'm going to cover up the loss of this week lecture by taking lecture on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, so that we can expedite our completion. Priya, better is to take the printout or take it the photocopy in the Xerox shop, but do take a color printout, because right now the logistic is an issue which we all know. So better not take a chance. Just go to their respective, you have the PDF file, go to their respective particular Xerox shop and tell him A3 color size. Take the 28 slides only. Okay, take 28 slides only. I think maximum he will charge you, say, 10 rupees per slide also. Still, you will be done with 280 rupees or 15 rupees per slide. Less than 300 rupees or so, you will be done with your 300 to 400 rupees. You will be done with your entire full printing, including the spiral binding. So that is the idea, that is what I can suggest to you, rather than other modes, which is difficult right now in this pandemic. Otherwise, my final CA charts are there, but again, which are there in physical form. Final CA charts are there. There are 50 charts which we distribute, but the problem is that the logistic is the real challenge at this stage. So don't take any chance. Students, please now come to the next part. Yes, Priyanka. David, if beneficiary is a company, David is asking, if beneficiary is a company, David, then in that case, that beneficiary, if it is a company, he is an employer, isn't it? Like, I can tell you, if you want an example, Balaji Telefilms has taken some 850 crores of Cayman insurance policy on Ekta Kapoor. That anything happens to Ekta Kapoor, then Balaji Telefilm will get from the insurance company 850 crore of rupee. That is the amount that Balaji Telefilm will get. So when the Balaji Telefilms will get 850 crore of rupee, will Balaji Telefilm will be charged under the head PGBP? And the answer is yes. They will be charged under the head PGBP. This is how it has to be comprehended. Fine, students. So hope that you have got hold with this point. Now, the last one, students, is 28.7. We will not do it right now. We will do it later on. We'll do this thing later on. So this is about, students, in this case. One last point, students. Very important point. Students, please be careful on this very important point. And that is about this 28.2e and 28.6a, even this section, specific charge. Specific charge under 28.2e and 28.6a. So what is this 28.2e? 28.2e, students, in this regard, if you see, with effect from AY 1920, compensation arising or cancellation of any business contract, students, any business contract, is specifically charged under the PGBP. Is specifically charged under the PGBP. I want to dictate one example to you, because these are very important case studies for your question in the exam. Please take one small an example, very small example. 28.2e example. Please write this example. Mr. A received rupees 5 lakhs from supplier, from, you can write, from L&T as a liquidated damage, students, as a liquidated damages for not supplying the Plant and machinery. As per the terms of the contract. The amount received by Mr. A shall be chargeable under the head PGBP. The amount received by Mr. A shall be chargeable under the head PGBP as such sum is received on cancellation of a business contract. This example. Justin, good morning. So Mr. A received rupees 5 lakhs from L&T as a liquidated damage for not supplying the plant and machinery as per the terms of the contract. Full stop. The amount received by Mr. A shall be chargeable under the head PGBP as such sum is received on cancellation of a business contract. Fine, students. Copied. So students, this is precisely how you should always keep in mind. These are the examples that they will give it to you. So keep in mind, is it a business contract whose cancellation or whose modification I am in receipt of some amount. And if the answer is yes, then in that particular amount will be chargeable in my hands under the head PGBP, students. Fine. Just keep in mind, students, these are the very important examples that we are sharing for your MCQ based question. And the last one now, 28.6a, is about what? Last one, students, is about what? If you talk about 28.6a, it is about the FMV of the inventory as on the date on which it is converted into or treated as a capital asset. Students, please pay attention to this example. In capital gains head, we have conversion of capital asset into stock in trade. Okay, that is what we have it in the head capital gains. Whereas under the head PGBP, a conversion of a stock in trade into a capital asset, then the chargeability for such conversion will take place under the head PGBP. So if a capital asset is converted into a stock in trade, that conversion is charged under the head capital gains. But if the stock in trade is converted into a capital asset, then this conversion is chargeable under the head PGBP. The common aspect in both, students, the common aspect in both is that the value which will be chargeable in these two heads of income would be the fair market value as on the date of conversion. Students, the fair market value as on the date of the conversion, this is the value on which both the heads will attract the chargeability. So the value as on the date of conversion will be the amount on which the chargeability would be attracted in both the heads. So this is what we all do so far as this particular point is concerned. Hopefully, students, you have done with this particular thing. All of you are through with this. Now we are done with section 28. So now then, students, PGBP section 28 is done. I am again repeating to all of you, please be careful. This is very important for your MCQ. Now comes the next step. Now, students, herein, so PGBP, you will write like this. All of you will prepare a chart. PGBP revision. how the revision will be done. Herein, point number one, charging section. (28.1 to 28.7) and please write below this MCQ. Then, deduction. Big deduction and the small deduction. Small deduction students, 30 and 31, 36 and 37. Biggest deduction is section 32. I'll fill up other particular section if required, but section 32. After that, disallowances, section 40, section 40A, section 43B. So disallowances, and the last part students is about what? Books of accounts and audit, which is 44AA and 44AB and presumptive income. Presumptive income, which is about 44AD, 44ADA and 44AE. Three sections, 44AD, 44ADA and 44AE. Please make this chart so that your master chart is ready for all of you for the revision purpose. Once the chart is complete, students, do let me know. So all that you are going to do, students, in all this chart which is there, what is this section all about? This section, students, is all about the adjustments. In all these sections, students, in all these sections, you are doing nothing but, primarily, you are doing nothing but the adjustments. Adjustments of these sections. Of these sections on the net profit, on the accounting profit for business to determine the chargeable profit and gains under this head. To determine the chargeable profit and gains under this head. I am not touching the last category, because last category students, presumptive income, this is not an adjustment. It is a separate section altogether. You all may be aware, in presumptive section what happens? 8% of gross receipt or 6% of gross receipt, isn't it? So some percentage is to be applied on receipt, and that is your deemed income. So that section is not about the adjustment. That section is a basis of alternate basis of determining your PGBP income. Alternate basis of determining your PGBP income. That is the role of section 44AD, 44AE, etc. 44AD, 44AE, etc. But here, the focus is on these from 28 till 43B. From 28 students till 43B, we will do the adjustment on the accounting profit of the business, so as to determine finally the PGBP, so as to determine the profit and gains which is chargeable under this particular head. If you are through with this, students, then we can proceed further, all of you. Which section you want me to touch upon first? The list is given to all of you students. So herein, Arvind, Priyanka, Nishank, Shriswara, Priya, which section you all want me to touch upon? So overwhelmingly, it is depreciation, section 32, Nishank and Priyanka. In depreciation students, tomorrow please also keep your module ready. We will solve some of the questions from your module also. Okay, so some questions from module also would be touched upon. So for depreciation is concerned, because depreciation, you can expect here, please write. Expect one, either MCQ or two, practical question. Practical question. Because in final CA, they ask good MCQ in depreciation. Although we don't get in final CA a separate practical question, but in inter CA, you can expect a separate practical question. Final CA, we have an MCQ and we have an adjustment in the total income question for depreciation part. That is what final CA would be. But in inter CA, MCQ and the practical, like the way it is given in the module. So we'll discuss those things. So let's start with the depreciation part, students, herein. So depreciation, because it's a very big section, students, we have to break it down. You'll use your notes and chart also. I'll just put it, but I want you, because it's a very big section, we'll just try to write something and try to understand the notes very clearly. Depreciation under section 32, students, you will make this compartment basis of depreciation. Second is about the condition for depreciation. The third one is eligible assets and rates. Fourth is actual cost, WDV. And the last one is apportionment of depreciation. What is the last one I have written? Apportionment. Apportionment of depreciation. Five concepts, students, in all. Now, there is a basis of depreciation, students, herein. So, we have got a SLM basis. Section, you can forget it. Everything is, I'm not putting the burden on the section. You can just write SLM. And here you can write block method. Block method. Option of SLM is to the eligible SSE. Can anyone tell me which is that eligible SSE who is entitled for SLM scheme of depreciation? Who is the eligible SSE and what is that eligible asset? What is that eligible asset on which the depreciation allowance is to be provided? Indeed, students. Very good. Eligible SSC family is the SSC engaged in power generating. See, these are the important MCQ based question, or power generating and distributing unit. Very good. Power generating or power generating and distributing unit, like Tata Power. There are many particular Adani Power. So all these SSC would be eligible for what? For the SLM scheme of depreciation. For the SLM scheme of depreciation. But students, not in all the asset, not in respect of all the asset that they will be eligible for the SLM scheme of depreciation. It is only for the eligible asset, that is the plant, eligible plant and machinery. Not all of them, only the eligible plant and machinery. This is simply put power grid plant. That's it. Only for them, students, that the SLM scheme is available. Rest for all the other SSC, mandatorily the depreciation allowance under section 32 has to be as per the block scheme. Power grid plant students. Now, even for Tata Power, Adani Power, even for these power generating unit, they have to follow the block scheme for what? For ineligible asset, for them they will have to follow the block method, because this method is applicable only to a category of a plant and machinery. That's it. But what about for the remaining asset for the same company? For them it will be the block method that will be made applicable. So that is one point, students, that you have to be careful. Now here, students, you will get one MCQ based question, and if they will target any MCQ question, this is what it is. So the MCQ question would be like this: plant purchased at rupees 100. Plant purchased at rupees 100. Rate of depreciation, say, I'm just giving a 10%. Okay, 10%. After two years, the plant is sold for, point number A, rupees 60. Point number B, rupees 90. And point number C, 110. Now these are the three independent case, students. What is the tax treatment? In each of the case above, you will have to give me the answer A, B and C. There are three different situation. In case A, the selling price was 60. In case B, the selling price is 90. And in case C, selling price is 110. This is what you can get it in the MCQ question. So SLM basis, students, only you have to revise this, because beyond that they will not give you any question. So this is your MCQ question. Tharun, all of you will make an attempt. Even though there is a mistake, still it's fine. At least you will know where you may have gone wrong. Please make an humble attempt. Get me the answer. Priyanka, in option A. Nishank. Priya, Shushant, Arvind, Purima. Tarun. Nishank. Very good, students, that you all are making an attempt. That itself is very much encouraging. Priya, Shushant, Arvind. So students, if you're all through with this, Purnima, Sushant. Yes, students, I think Priyanka. At least now, let us now get the answer for the same. May you all have made a very good attempt. One thing you will realize that after 2 years, after 2 years, the WDV students is rupees 80, 10 rupees at the rate of 10%. If the depreciation rate is at the rate of 10%, so the WDV will become 80, isn't it? Now, in this context, students, in this context, with the depreciation at rupees 80, after 2 years, the WDV is at rupees 80. Herein, students, point number A, when the selling price is rupees 60, so obviously there is a loss of 20. Now this loss is allowed as deduction, under the head, PGBP as a terminal depreciation, students. Terminal means last. What do you mean by terminal? Terminal means last depreciation. So this loss is allowed as deduction as a terminal depreciation under section 32. So it will not go under the head capital gains. It will be under the head PGBP. That is point number A. Point number B, students, as you got it right, there is a surplus. The selling price is rupees 90. So students, there is a surplus or profit, of rupees 10, isn't it? Now there is a section 41, students. As per this section 41, what it says, surplus to the extent of the deduction earlier allowed, under the head PGBP will be charged only under the head, which head it will be chargeable, only under the head PGBP. So surplus to the extent of the deduction earlier allowed under the head PGBP will be charged only under the head PGBP. So can you tell me how much was the deduction earlier allowed under the head PGBP? How much was the deduction earlier allowed under the head PGBP. How much was the deduction earlier allowed under the head PGBP? Get me the answer quickly. How much was the deduction earlier allowed under the head PGBP? It was indeed 20. 20 was the deduction earlier allowed. The deduction you took from 100, you took the deduction of 20. So therefore, 20, yes Manju, 20 was allowed as deduction to you earlier. So therefore, surplus to the extent of the deduction earlier allowed will be charged under the head PGBP. And therefore, if you come to point number C, when the selling price is rupees 110, then your surplus students, or your profit is how much? Is rupees 30. And if your surplus or your profit is rupees 30, then in that particular case, up to rupees 20, the surplus shall be charged. Under the head PGBP, and balance 10, where it will go? It will go under the head chargeable, under which head? Capital gains. Why capital gains? Because any case it is a transfer of an asset. Any case students, it is a transfer of an asset, and because it is a transfer of an asset, therefore the balance has to be charged under the head capital gains. Yes Manju. So the balance 10 chargeable under the head capital gains. But please understand, this SLM method is very clear. It says that look, if you transfer this eligible asset on which you have earlier taken the deduction on SLM basis, if you transfer this eligible asset on which earlier you have taken the deduction on the SLM basis, then on such transfer, check out what is the consequence. What is the net result of this transfer? If the net result of this transfer is a loss, then take the deduction of this loss under the head PGBP as a terminal depreciation. But if the net result of this transfer is a profit, then please ensure that the profit, which is to the extent of the deduction that you have earlier taken under the head PGBP, that much of the profit will be chargeable under the head PGBP. And if there is any excess profit over and above that amount, then that will go under the head. Under which head, students? Under the head capital gains. This is how it has to be considered. So I hope that, students, this particular point is well taken now by all of you in this regard. So this much only, students, you should just revise. For what? You should revise for the SLM. With this, now we come to the block scheme. The block scheme, students. The block method, students, is in section 43, subsection 6. The block method is in section 43, subsection 6. Students, now please understand the format of the block that we all prepare. You will prepare this format. Date, you have to write. Particulars. Date, particulars. Number of unit and the amount. I am, students, just ensuring that the depreciation part I am making you write and revise is what I am doing for depreciation, for the obvious reason we all know depreciation is a tricky one, and definitely in PGBP you will get a good question, and one question would be there. Expect one question from depreciation part in your examination. Priyanka, sir, the deduction earlier allowed, does it mean the past deduction, sir? Yes, Priyanka, but the deduction in the form of depreciation. The deduction in the form of depreciation as per the SLM method. The deduction, which is, we are talking about it, is a deduction in the form of depreciation under the SLM method. So that is one. Now, from 1st of April of the previous year, you have the open WDV. Say, for example, the block that you prepare, this block is for a plant, and the plant rate of depreciation is 15%. So there is an open WDV. Say the number of unit is set to, and then there is a rupees that they've given is say 2.5 lakhs. Fine. Then say 30th of June of the previous year, there is an additions which has been made, a new additions, and this additions is on the basis of the actual cost. One asset enters into your block, say the value in that is 1 lakh. Okay. Say thereafter 31st December of the previous year, money payable I dot R dot O means in respect of, I dot R dot O means in respect of the asset sold, discarded, scrapped, demolished, etc. Say there is one asset which has gone, and in this case, say it is 50,000. Say it is 50,000. Then on 31st of March of the previous year, you will have what? The closing WDV. 31st of March of the previous year, students, you will have what? The closing WDV before depreciation. Before depreciation. So I have got in all two assets still. And in that 3 lakhs is the value, and accordingly then I will say, since the block exists plus it has still the WDV in the block, therefore I will go ahead and charge the depreciation allowance under section 32. And say at 15% it comes to 45,000, and that way it gives me what? The opening WDV of the next year, next previous year. Opening WDV of the next previous year. So 2, and this results into 2,55,000. 2,55,000. If you have copied on this, just let me know. Because we are supposed to make some sort of twist and turns in this format. Nishant, Shiva. Through with the students now. Okay, now students, in this regard, now all of you have copied down this one. Some students will argue, sir, what is this money payable? What does it imply? Does it imply that you have to sell the asset and then you have to also pay the money? Is it that the case that you are selling the asset also and you have to also pay the money? No, students, it's not about that. That you have to sell the asset also and you have to pay the money. What kind of anyone who have known like this? That I have to sell, I'm selling it to you, my pen, and I have to pay you money also to sell my pen. And this is not the case. Money payable means from the buyer perspective, how much money he has to pay on this asset which I'm transferring. There is an implication, students, why they are using this word, but this is not for you at inter CA level to understand this implication. At final CA level, I'll let you know. But please, I just want you to not to substitute this term money payable with money received. Why money payable they have written, that I will let you know in final CA. But only part which I want you right now is not to substitute this term with money received. The meaning changes. You will say, why, where meaning changes? I'll prove it, but not now in final CA. Right now, only money payable you'll write. Money payable. Only what you need to know is that how much the buyer is going to pay me for the asset which I am going to transfer to him. That is what is money payable. In respect of what? The asset which is sold, discarded, scrapped. So, students, please understand I have to receive the money. Now, whether if I'm selling the money, if I'm selling the asset, then the money will be received from the buyer. If supposedly there's a destruction of the asset because of the natural calamity, then I will receive the money from whom? From the insurance company. The insurance company will pay me the money. So whatever it be, I need to receive the money. If I'm selling, then I'm going to receive from the buyer. If there's a destruction of the asset, or the asset is demolished and that is an insured asset, the insurance was taken on that asset, then I'm going to receive the money from the insurance company. That is what will be considered as the money which is payable by the insurance company to me in respect of my asset, and that is what will be reduced. So just be very careful as far as this particular point is concerned. On 30th of June of the previous year, in respect of the additions, the value at which the asset will enter into the block, will be at the actual cost. That is what would be the value at which the asset will enter into the block. And the opening WDV, as you all know, two assets are there, and 2.5 lakhs is what would be the amount in this regard. So students, this is primarily how the things are placed in this context. Now I will twist and turns certain numbers over here. First of all, students, I'll ask you one question. This asset, one of the asset, has been sold on 31st of December of the previous year. My question therefore to all of you is this. Whether you will be giving proportionate depreciation, for that 9 months period in previous year, the relevant previous year, before the asset has been transferred. So at least I can say that for 9 months period the asset was being used. So will I be giving the proportionate depreciation? That is my question to all of you. Please do answer quickly. Will I be giving the proportionate depreciation in this regard? Purnima, Arvind, Deepak, Keswan, Priyanka, will I be giving the proportionate depreciation in respect of that asset which I have sold on 31st of December? Priya, Dharmesh, Trinad, Nishank. Again, I'm repeating the question. Will I be giving proportionate depreciation in respect of the asset which I have transferred in previous year? That is 31st of December. So students, I think all of you have made your attempt, and let me then conclude in this case. Answer is, you will not be getting any depreciation in respect of that asset. Which asset? Which you have sold during the previous year. Why is it so? There are a lot of heartbreaks, isn't it? Why is it so that you are not allowed the depreciation, the proportionate depreciation in respect of those assets? Why is it so? For the reason being, students, if you can pay attention, be careful. Please pay attention here. For the reason being, in this situation, just see, the depreciation under section 32 is applied on what? On the closing WDV. The depreciation, students, is on the closing WDV. is the asset which you have transferred during the previous year, that is on 31st of December, is this asset forming a part of your closing WDV? Is this asset forming a part of your closing WDV? And the answer is no. This asset does not form part of your closing WDV. The fact that this asset doesn't form part of your closing WDV, therefore the question of claiming the depreciation allowance will not arise. Therefore, the question of claiming what? The depreciation allowance will not arise in respect of that asset which you have sold, because that asset is removed from the block, and because the asset is removed from the block, it doesn't form part of the closing WDV. And since it doesn't form part of the closing WDV, the question of claiming the depreciation will not arise, because you apply what? The depreciation rate. You apply the depreciation rate on the closing WDV value of the asset. You apply the depreciation rate on the closing WDV value of the asset. And in your closing WDV value of the asset, you tell me, in that 3 lakhs, do you have this asset in that particular closing WDV? And the answer is no. So therefore, students, never have this concept that proportionate depreciation will be arise. In accounting, you may do it, but under the income tax law, students, you will never do this. Under the income tax law, you will never do this. Yes, Pawan Kumar, that is the answer, because it doesn't form part of the block. It is already removed. It is eliminated. So therefore, it doesn't form part of what? Your closing WDV. And because it doesn't form part of your closing WDV, therefore the question of claiming a depreciation allowance will not arise. One more point, students, in the block scheme of depreciation, you don't provide the depreciation on the single individual asset. In the case of the block scheme of depreciation, you will not provide a depreciation on a single individual asset. The depreciation, if at all it is provided, it is provided on the WDV value of the block of the asset. The WDV value of the block of the asset. So, in respect of the WDV value of the block of the asset, that the depreciation allowance is provided. And that is the reason why I say that on the closing WDV, that is as on 31st of March, that the depreciation allowance will be provided. Did you all got this one, students? All of you? Yeah, that 180 days, many students who have answered me about 180 days, that 180 days, students, is in respect of what? 180 days is in respect of the addition herein. Okay, for that 180 days. But here we are talking about the sale asset. My question was altogether on the asset which was being sold. That is where my question was. And that is what I asked you, that for that asset which I have sold, whether there would be any depreciation allowance. To that, the answer is no, because it doesn't form part of my WDV. And under the block scheme, the depreciation is not on the individual asset. It is on what? It is on the closing WDV value of the block and not the closing WDV value of the individual asset. That is the difference between the block scheme versus the individual asset for which the SLM method has been provided to all of you. Can you just take a quick note, students, on this one? And then couple of more situations, I have to give a twist to all of you, and then we'll wind it up quickly. I'm dictating you. You'll take a quick note. If the asset is transferred during the previous year, in respect of which, the money is payable on such asset, then it will not form part of the closing WDV, it will not form part of the closing WDV value of the asset. It will not form part of the closing WDV value of the asset. It will not form part of the closing WDV value of the asset. Full stop. Since it does not form part of the closing WDV value of the asset, the closing WDV value of the asset, therefore since it doesn't form part of the closing WDV value of the asset, therefore the depreciation allowance on the asset transferred during the previous year, the depreciation allowance on the asset transferred during the previous year shall not be allowed. On the asset transferred during the previous year shall not be allowed, irrespective of the number of days, irrespective of the number of days the asset was used, irrespective of the number of days the asset was used. Asset was used during the previous year. Full stop. Fine, students. So just keep in mind this proposition very, very carefully. Keep in mind, students, this proposition very, very carefully. Okay. Now, my next question, students. Yes, Priyanka, that was it. So that is one of the point that please don't make a mistake on this part. Students, let me give another twist. If I just change my answer over here like this. Instead of 50,000, I say this to be how much? 4 lakhs. What is the net result? What is the net result in MCQ? So write a question. If in the above case study, comma, the selling price is rupees 4 lakhs instead of rupees 50,000. If in the above case study, the selling price is rupees 4 lakh instead of rupees 50,000. Please tell me, students, what you are going to do in this case then. Selling price is rupees 4 lakh instead of rupees 50,000. What is that you are going to do? I want a very perfect answer. See, 50-60% kind of an answer even I can, anyone can give, and everyone would be right. I want a very perfect answer because I know where you will go wrong. I want a 100% perfect answer. What is the implication if I say the selling price is 4 lakhs in the same block? Selling price is 4 lakhs. Deepak, Arvind, Nishan, Pavan Kumar, Priyanka. No, only one asset, Priyanka. In my question, it is only one asset. So there are total up till now three assets, 2 plus 1. So only one asset has been sold, and it has been sold for rupees 4 lakh. This is the question. Purnima. So these are the MCQ based question, students. Let's see. All of you contribute to your answers quickly. Priya. So students, the answer for this particular point is Pawan, Priyanka, Arvind, Trinath. Fair enough. I think substantially the students have given their answer. So the answer, Rahul, answer for PGBP head. For PGBP head, you will write like this, that the block exists. Block still exists with two asset, but at nil value. Those who have said that the block value has got negative, no, the block value does not get negative. It is up to nil value. And for the head capital gains, what do you write? There is section 50, and because the block is at nil value, therefore here, because the block is at nil value, therefore no depreciation. Because the block is at nil value, therefore what? Therefore no depreciation. For the head capital gain, section 50, which is there. So as you got it right, it is rupees what? For the head capital gains in this scenario, it is 1,45,000. So what was the capital gains amount? 1.5 lakhs. So the CG and 50, which is short term capital gains. So you will always write like this. So the basic mistake in the MCQ question would be that you will write that block to be negative. Please don't do that, students. At least ICI at your IPC level will expect you to know this kind of a fundamental concepts on depreciation. How to make the block, all these are the IPCC based question. In finance here, there are a lot of other advanced case studies, case laws, which are there, which right now you don't have to do it, but the fundamentals needs to be very clear. Okay, if that is the case, students, let me ask you then the last one, students, in the same block format. Okay, so the last one, if in the original case study all the three asset was sold for rupees 50,000 then what is the implication? What is the implication? So what is the answer? If in the original case study all the three assets was sold for rupees 50,000, then what is the implication? quickly, Shruth. In this case, the answer would be, so PGVP, what do you say? Block ceased to exist. Block ceased to exist as on the last day of the previous year. As on the last day of the previous year. So if it does not exist, students, if it does not exist, then the question of depreciation will not arise. So if it does not exist, the block ceases to exist in this particular case. If the block ceases to exist in this particular case, then the question of depreciation, will it arise? And the answer is no. The question of depreciation will not arise. How about the capital gains? Short-term capital loss under section 50. How much is that for? In this case, it is 3 lakhs. 3 lakhs would be the short-term capital loss. 3 lakhs would be the short-term capital loss. Did you all got this one, students? Fine. So this is the permutation and combination in respect of the block that you have to be very careful about it. If you are done with this, then I'll take across the last one point quickly. Priyanka, even though the block has balance in WDV, as there is no asset, no depreciation will be charged. Yes, there's no depreciation will be charged. So block ceased to exist as on the last day of the previous year, and therefore this is the scenario. If you are through with this one now, students, all of you, now we go, this is the basis of depreciation. What is the next point which I have told you was about the condition. The condition of the claim of depreciation, students, the condition for the claim of depreciation. There are two conditions technically. So the conditions right here in point number two, what is the condition? The condition point number two. And the conditions are, there are two conditions. One is the ownership and another is a put to use. Ownership and another is what? Put to use, students. So unless and until you put to use the asset, you will not get the depreciation. Students, so two conditions are there. One is the ownership condition and second is the put to use condition. So unless and until both these two conditions are satisfied, unless and until both these two conditions are satisfied, you will not be getting the benefit of the depreciation. You will not be getting the benefit of the depreciation. So if you see over here, if I may just come to the same point of this thing, when you see additions that you have done here, when the asset is entering into the block, when you see additions and the asset is entering, when it is entering into the block, what is this date? This is the date where it is put to use. This is not the date of purchase. Students, this is not the date of purchase. This is the date where it is put to use, when the asset is put to use. So that is one thing that you should always keep in mind, that this is not the date of your purchase, but this is the date when the asset is put to use. Fine. Now, in that regard, if you go about this one, so the conditions which you are putting across it, so mere purchase of the asset will not qualify for the depreciation allowance. The asset needs to be put to use. So you can just quickly write, mere purchase of the asset will not qualify for depreciation unless the asset is put to use. So far as the ownership is concerned, students, question is title versus beneficial owner. What is required? Should I be a title owner or a beneficial owner? What do you mean by beneficial owner? Students, beneficial owner means the one who has got the absolute control over the asset. Beneficial owner means title means the name owner. Beneficial means the one who possess the asset and uses it for the purpose of business and profession. And is entitled to hold the asset to the exclusion of all the other person. So one who is possessing the asset and he is using the asset for the purpose of his own business profession and is entitled to hold the asset and is entitled to hold the asset to the exclusion of all the other person. So in the question that is there, students, which is to be carefully to be understood, is that what is relevant? Is the title relevant? My name should be there in that asset. Will that make me the owner? And the answer is no, students. There is a lot of judgment, but we are, as I told you, in IPCC, we don't have to worry about the judgments at all. Just remember this much in IPCC, in your inter CA. And what is that you have to remember? It is a beneficial owner who will be eligible for the claim of the depreciation. Who is the beneficial owner? So, like between you and me, students, I have sold you this asset. Okay, I have sold you this asset. Fine, we have exchanged the documents. There is an agreement between us. Okay, now this particular asset is registered in my name with the relevant authority. Okay, but what I have done, between both of us, I have sold you this asset. We have got our own agreement. You have paid me the consideration also. And therefore, now you are possessing this asset. You are using this asset for your business and profession. Even though the title would be of me with the relevant authority, the title is with of this asset is in my name. But still, because of that agreement that we have shared between both of us, because of the consideration that you have paid, which is also registered in the agreement, all these factors makes you entitled to hold this asset. All these factors entitles you to hold this asset to the exclusion of me. So I am excluded completely, students. I cannot hold this asset at all. It is you who will be eligible for the depreciation. So please understand one thing and remember one thing. In the depreciation allowance, the title has got no relevance. It is the one who is possessing, using and entitled to hold. Three things, repeat with me: possessing, using and entitled to hold. That is a person who will be eligible for depreciation. That is a person who will be eligible for the depreciation. Did you all got this one? All of you, students. So possessing, using and the third one, which I have told you, was about what? In this case, the entitled to hold. So this is how it has to be considered, students, and that exactly is the point. I hope that all of you have got hold with this particular concept. Fine, students. Okay, so with this, we have done with this particular condition part. So remember, possess, use and entitled to hold. This is the owner. That person is the one who would be referred to be the owner. That person would be the one who would be referred to be the owner. Now, students, your assignment is ready. Congratulations. You will read one particular part from the chart or from your booklet and then come tomorrow for the session where we are going to do the practical problem. Tomorrow, students, I want your modules also ready. We are going to solve. Yes, Priya, possessing, use and entitled to hold. So you will keep your modules ready. So what is that you are going to deal with it in the tomorrow session? In one chart, students, I just want you to go through the rates of depreciation. Can you see the rate of depreciation here? These are the rates of depreciation, students. This is your assignment for today. Please do this and come. Rate of depreciation. And also want your module also keep it ready. I think module you will have a physical copy with you. Or if not there, then please download from the ICI website. Module has to be there with you. Because some key questions I'm going to solve from that module. Based on my discussion which I'm going to have it tomorrow. Tomorrow also, students, the same timing we will be meeting at 9:45. Okay. And I will also ask Om sir about his availability. And I'll let you know in tomorrow's session for the IT NSM. And I think evening you are having FM lecture. So we'll continue with this pre. And I'll keep you updated. So students, everything which has been there, I'm just sharing with all of you. So I'll meet you tomorrow. So tomorrow, Friday, Saturday and Sunday, I'm continuing with my lectures because of the loss of Monday to Wednesday, which we couldn't take it across. So Friday, Saturday and Sunday, I'm continuing with the session in this week. Okay, so that would be the way. Any queries that you have, you can let me know. Thank you, Priyanka. Yes, Abhi, any case, see, are for us, unfortunately or fortunately, whatever you have to say, but you have to travel a bit for our studios and all. But that is one of the incidents. The bit of risk factor is always there. You all, as I told you initially also, students, and I'm repeating it again, please ensure to not venture out unnecessarily. Now try to maintain your health. That is very equally important. Do yoga, meditation, a bit of it, because fatigueness is also there for quite a long. This is a very big stretch that you all are having. Spend some quality time to relax your mind, but don't go outside to relax your mind. That is my only humble request to all of you, and just take care of your health, which is very important at this point of time, and everything will fall in place. It's just a matter of now days, some months are there. We just need to trade off this month very carefully. Thank you, students. Any queries that you may have, you can let me know, and I can answer it if possible. Thank you, Nishank. So 9:45, students, tomorrow we'll see then. Fine. Thank you.